As you said, I will talk about a hot and controversial topic, which is the management of poor viral responders. These are my conflicts of interest that have nothing to do with the presentation. So, poor viral responders remain a challenge for everyday clinical practice. And in 2011, my good friend Nikos Polizos published this commentary in order to criticize the variety of definitions using the literature for this group of women. And the same year, ESRE came with the famous Bologna criteria in order to refine this population. However, 9 years later, we are still wondering whether Bologna criteria were the solution to our problem and whether Bologna criteria brought our patients out of the tunnel into the light. And I think it's not by chance that approximately 50%, even more, 51% of studies published after the introduction of Bologna criteria did not use this criteria for the clinical design. I think this is quite surprising. Regarding Bologna poor responders, life birth rates have been described to be quite low. This study comes from my center in Brussels, a big series of patients, showing life birth rates of 6%. And one might say, well, you have so bad results because you are not very good doctors in Brussels. But unfortunately, these results were replicated later by other investigators showing life birth rates that do not exceed 10%. One of the main limitations of Bologna criteria, and have been criticized for this, is that they do not take into account important parameters for the prognosis of our patients, such as age. And this year, this is an article published in April 2020, we made this study with Michel DeVos. So the idea was to compare cumulative life birth rates, so the probability to have a life birth either in the fresh or in one of the following frozen cycles, between patients fulfilling the Bologna criteria, but who differ according to age. So as you may see, we had 4 different patterns. Pattern 1, 2, 3 were older Bologna poor responders, whether pattern 4 were younger Bologna poor responders. And as expected, we found a significant difference in cumulative life birth rate, meaning that patients belonging to pattern 4 had the best outcome. I think that it's something expected. As I said before, there are different parameters that are not taken into account with the Bologna criteria, and this is the main reason that a couple of years ago, a group of endocrinologists introduced the Poseidon classification, the Poseidon criteria. So according to the Poseidon, you know, we have 4 group of patients that differ according to age. So group 1 and 3 are below 35, while patients belonging to group 2 and 4 are over 35. And for a while I was thinking, why did they choose the cutoff of 35? And the answer is found in this very nice graph. As you may see, aploidy rates, so the probability to have a genetically normal embryo, declines with age, and this decline is more pronounced after the age of 35. So that's why they chose the cutoff of 35. So if we take a look to this classification, we have group 3 and 4. These patients are patients with low ovarian reserve markers, so low AMH, low AFC, that differ according to age, so could be classified as expected poor ovarian responders. And on the other hand, we have some other patients belonging to group 1 and 2 that are patients with normal ovarian reserve markers who, for different reasons, respond poorly or suboptimally, if you want, following conventional ovarian stimulation. And we do care about these patients because they represent approximately 50% of patients that you see in your everyday clinical practice. It's a huge proportion. Anyhow, I would say that the aim when we stimulate either expected or unexpected viral responders should be to try to increase the number of eggs. Why? Because we have evidence from this landmark paper by Sunkara that you see probably in all congresses worldwide, showing that an increase in the number of oocytes is associated with an increase in live birth rate. And furthermore, it seems that this holds true also for Bologna poor responders. You see, if you get more eggs, you have a higher probability to have a baby at the end of IVF. So I will start by presenting the different treatment modalities that we can use for expected poor ovarian responders, and then I will move to unexpected poor ovarian responders. And let's start with the downregulation protocol that you should use for your expected poor ovarian responders. Should you use the agonist, the antagonist, or the short flare-up? This is a very nice randomized study published in 2014. As you may see, expected poor ovarian responders included. And the authors compared the agonist with the antagonist and the short flare-up protocol. And this study was powered on the number of oocyte trips. So if we take a look at the results, it seems that if we compare the agonist with the antagonist, there is no significant difference regarding the number of oocytes. However, it seems that the agonist performs significantly better compared to the agonist because, as you may see, we have more oocytes with the agonist. These results were replicated by a recent meta-analysis published in Human Reproduction Update. As you may see, ongoing pregnancy rates were similar between agonist and antagonist protocol. So in conclusion, I would say that for your expected poor ovarian responders, you can use either the agonist or the antagonist protocol. At the end, the result will be similar. Here I present you just a study that was published two years ago because it's the only one done in Poseidon responders. And the authors of this study found that for Poseidon group 4, Poseidon group 4 are patients over 35 expected poor ovarian responders, it seems that the agonist and the antagonist result in similar live birth rates. However, in group 3, so in expected poor ovarian responders below the age of 35, it seems that the agonist results in significantly higher live birth rates. I think that we need more evidence. This is only one study, and in fact, we don't have a rationale to support this hypothesis. Let's now move to other stimulation challenges that we may encounter. And the question that follows is whether the type of gonadotropins may affect your outcome. Well, fortunately, we have the guidelines published by ESRE this year in Human Reproduction Open. And based on the conclusion, we have no evidence, no historical evidence that one gonadotropin is superior to another. So for your poor responders, for your expected poor ovarian responders, you can use whatever you like. The result will not change significantly. However, regarding the dose, here we need to pay attention because sometimes I see doctors probably that are not very experienced in IVF stimulating patients with 600 units, even more. And the message is quite clear. Please do not go over 300 units per day because it seems that either you stimulate your patient with 300, 450, or 600 units per day, at the end, live birth rates will be the same. If you have a patient with an AFC of 2 or 3, unfortunately, till now, in any case, you cannot generate oocytes. So it's better to give a conventional dose of 300, also for financial reasons, than go to higher doses. Could natural cycle be an option? And I think that this question is not really valid because, as we said before, the idea is to increase the number of oocytes. So how can you increase the number of oocytes if you use the natural cycle, given that in such case you have one or sometimes two oocytes retrieved? And if we take a look at the results of this nice study, results, live birth rates were low with natural cycle, irrespective of the age of the patient. On the other hand, managed natural cycle could be an option. In managed natural cycle, we give a small dose of gonadotropins at the end of the follicular phase. And in this study that we published last year in NBM Online, we compare managed natural cycle with high dose of ovarian stimulation in advanced age Bologna poor responders, so in women 40 or over. If you take a look at the results, we found no difference in ongoing pregnancy rates. So yes, mild natural cycle, and in general, I would say mild stimulation could be an option for your expected pool of ovarian responders. This is another study, a randomized study, compare non-inferiority, comparing 150 units with 450 units, 400 patients randomized. And again, as you may see, no difference in ongoing pregnancy rates between mild stimulation and conventional stimulation, ongoing pregnancy rates close to 13%. Dual stimulation. This is, I would say, a quite recent concept. You know very well that during a menstrual cycle, we may have two or three waves. And the dual stimulation was first introduced by Quag with the famous Sangai protocol, and was further developed by Ubaldi with the dual stim protocol. So the idea is to do two stimulations in a short time frame, and therefore increase the number of oocytes and the number of available embryos. So based on the Ubaldi protocol, you stimulate in an antagonist protocol with a relatively high dose of valoctropins. You trigger with an agonist, you do your pickup, and a few days later, you restart the same protocol. And it has been shown that if we compare exploit rates between patients having a follicular or luteal stimulation, there is absolutely no difference. So it's clear that if you perform two stimulations, one after the other, at the end, you will have more oocytes and more embryos. Another crucial question is, because also this is something that we see quite often, is if we must perform ICSI in case of a patient with a low number of oocytes. And we gave the answer to this question last year. We compared fertilization rates in patients with non-male factor infertility according to ovarian response, And as you may see, we found no difference in fertilization rates for patients having IVF or ICSI. So please, there is no reason to use ICSI for your poor responders if there is no male factor, of course. PGS or PGDA. Should we perform PGDA in expected poor ovarian responders? Well, I would say no. This is another recent study comparing live birth rates between patients having PGS and patients without PGS. As you may see, live birth rates per oocyte retrieval were not significantly different between the two groups. So the conclusion is that PGS does not improve live birth rates in poor responders. And also, you may think you must think that you need to do the biopsy in the blastocyst stage. So how many of these expected poor ovarian responders will manage to get to the blastocyst stage? So I would say that it's better to avoid PGDA in your expected poor ovarian responders. Adjuvant therapy. This is another big chapter. And of course, I will not talk to you about DHEA that probably you see everywhere in the market. Why? Because DHEA is a preandrogen that needs to be converted to testosterone in order to act. And although we had some first studies that were quite promising, showing that patients may go up to 18 oocytes with DHEA, further randomized studies did not show a benefit with DHEA administration. And as I said before, DHEA is a preandrogen, so why not to give testosterone directly? And indeed, we have a meta-analysis showing that testosterone could increase live birth rates in poor responders. But always when you have a meta-analysis, you need to check for two things. First of all, the number of studies included, so you see here only three, and the number of patients, so 113, 112, so very low number of patients. And in all these studies, the duration of testosterone administration did not exceed 21 days. But from a physiological point of view, this is wrong. Why? Because we know that androgens act in the preantral stage. And if we take into account that preantral follicles need approximately 2 months to go to the antral stage, if you give testosterone only for a couple of days, you cannot have a benefit even if there is one. That's why actually we perform one of the largest multicenter randomized studies in which we give testosterone for 2 months before starting ovarian stimulation, which is done in a long agonist protocol with 300 units per day of HMG. I hope to be able to present these results in 2-3 years from now, because the recruitment is not very easy. It's not very easy. We had always problems with the recruitment of poor responders. Growth hormone. I would say that the story of growth hormone is similar to that of testosterone. You know that growth hormone, there are some animal studies showing that growth hormone may increase oocyte and embryo quality. Again, a meta-analysis with a low number of patients from the Cochrane group showing positive results in case of growth hormone supplementation. But 4 years ago, in ESRE, Norman from Australia presented the results of a well-designed randomized study that was also published last year in NBM Online, showing no significant difference in live birth rates after randomization of 130 patients. Another randomized study also confirmed that there is no difference, not only in fresh live birth rate, but also in cumulative live birth rates in case of growth hormone supplementation. Of course, there are other interesting concepts like in vitro activation, mitochondrial boosting, the role of stem cells, but actually these results are preliminary and it's too early to implement them into clinical practice. And let's now move to the unexpected poor or suboptimal responders. Just to remind you, we talk about group 1 and 2 based on the Poseidon classification. And in order to understand what is going on, we need to make the difference between ovarian reserve and ovarian response. So we have the follicular output rate, which is a very good marker for the quality of your response. So let's say you have a patient with an AFC of 10 that ends with 9 big preovulatory follicles. We have an AFC of 20, and at the end we have 10 preovulatory follicles. So in that case, the response is not very good. On the other hand, you may have a patient with a low ovarian reserve, so an AFC of 4, that ends with 3 big follicles. So in that case, the response is good. So follicular output rate could be defined as the number of preovulatory follicles divided by AFC multiplied by 100. So in the first case, we have an unexpected suboptimal or poor responder, while in the second case, we have an expected poor prognosis patient. And why do we care so much about this unexpected ovarian response? We care so much because, as I said in the beginning, the number of oocytes is significantly associated with live birth rates, not only the first cycle, but as you may see here, also with cumulative live birth rate. So a patient with 4 to 9 oocytes has significantly lower cumulative live birth rates compared to a patient with 10 to 15 oocytes. And which is the reason, which is the cause of this unexpected poor or suboptimal response? Well, we have many theories. For instance, if you give to your patient a stimulation dose, a daily stimulation dose of 75 units per day, we see that sometimes. Or if you have difficulties in the pickup, it's clear that in that case, the response will not be very good. But the most dominant theory is that these patients with unexpected poor or suboptimal response have polymorphisms in the receptors or the genes of gonadotropins. And what can we do in our clinical practice in order to improve their outcome? So one option would be to increase the starting dose in the second cycle. And in 2018, we evaluated the second cycle of patients with an initial suboptimal response. So all these patients had an initial cycle with 150 units, and the second cycle was performed in a period of less than 12 months. If we take a look at this graph, it's clear that if we increase the dose in the second cycle, we get more oocytes. And we found that an increase by 50 units in the starting dose will result in one more egg. I think that this is very important for this difficult group of women. Of course, dual stimulation could also be applied for unexpected responders. If you have a patient with, let's say, that has an AFC of 10 that ends with 4 oocytes for unknown reasons, you can start directly with a second stimulation a few days later, and you can have a second pickup in order to increase the final total number of eggs. So I would like to reach the conclusions of my presentation. First of all, I think that you all agree that prognosis is not the same for all Bologna responders. Poseidon criteria is a new concept. Personally, I agree with Poseidon classification, but Poseidon criteria need to be validated. Actually, we have practically no studies done in Poseidon responders. So we need studies, we need more evidence for the Poseidon classification. For your expected Poseidon responders, you can use either the agonist or the antagonist protocol. Please do not go over 300 units per day. Mild stimulation might be an option for some patients. I think that we need more evidence for dual stim, growth hormone, and androgens in general. ICSI should be used only in case of male factor infertility. Fourth is the marker of quality of your response, as we said before. I believe that the nature of unexpected Poseidon response merits further investigation. And at that moment, what we can do for our patient is probably to increase the dose in the second cycle or maybe apply a dual stim protocol. And pharmacogenomics may be the future. That means that maybe in the future you can do a blood test, see if the patient has a polymorphism, and you can adapt the dose of stimulation accordingly. I'd like to thank you very much for your attention.